Hello, I'm Spencer Crew of the National Museum of American History, and I'd like to welcome you to Field to Factory, Voices of the Great Migration. From the beginning of the First World War to the start of the Second, African Americans migrated in great numbers from the farms of the southern United States to the cities of the North. This massive relocation forever changed the face of the urban North, as it did the lives of those who chose to make the trip. For blacks, the North promised to be a place where you could escape the difficult living conditions and humiliating segregation of the South. But the realities of the move held many surprises. These are the voices of four people who lived the Great Migration. The first, William Brown, was born in Jacksonville, Florida in 1897.
My father was a carpenter. When he had a big tool chest as long as that table there, and that wide. It took two strong men to lift all the tools that he had in that chest and put them on a dray, horse and wagon, and take them down to the station, the railroad station, and put them in a baggage car. Then those caps, those red caps down there, would take it out the baggage car and lay it on a platform until he got there and get a dray to take it from there to where they were going away. And when he went, took that chest away, we didn't see him sometime for 6 months. So all that time, Mama had the whole responsibility of teaching us things. I remember her very well. She says, son, I would get down on my knees just like that and just lay on, just get her and let her, and just look up at her and just let her talk to me. She said, son, remember this. Never let anyone be nicer to you than you will be to them. Never let anybody do that. And if anybody does something good for you, always say thank you. Don't never take it for granted. Always be grateful for somebody when they do something to you. I put that a part of my life, and that's been my life ever since.
My name is Ernestine Wright, and I was born in Eudora, Arkansas, March the 4th, 1908. I never knew my mother and father. They both expired. I was about a year old when my father passed, and I was about two when my mother passed. My mother died in childbirth. My father went out to get the mules to hitch up to the wagon to go to get the doctor for my mother who was ill. And he got caught in a drizzle of cold drizzle rain, and he caught 3-day pneumonia, and he expired. He died. My grandmother raised us because my parents died early.
Well, my name is Alfonso Olive, and I was born in Tennessee. In other words, I was born out from Paris, Tennessee. I was born January the 25th, 1912. Well, I lived out in the country, out from Paris, Tennessee. On the farm that I was raised on, the mostly we raised in that area was tobacco and corn. And true enough, we had to plow with mules. We didn't have such things as tractors and all that kind. And we was too small to do the heavy plowing, but I had an uncle, had a John in farm to ours. He would do all the heavy plowing and stuff like that. And we kids would do all the other type of work. Now, I used to have to plow when I wasn't big enough to throw a plow around at the end of the row. I had to circle out and come back in to handle it. You know? So it was pretty rugged life, but we enjoyed it. We didn't have a whole lot of money, but we had plenty of what we had. You know?
My name is Earlene Lindsay. I was born in Greensboro, Alabama in 1925. Growing up in my family was good because there's 18 children, 15 boys and 3 girls, but there was a lot of love in my family. We were sharecroppers, dirt farmers, and we worked the fields. My early childhood was in way down in the boondocks, just out of the way of everything. And we didn't even have a wagon or a mule. We walked to church. And the house was just a little frame house where in the wintertime, if you were lucky enough to get newspaper or catalog, you took that catalog and you put up wallpaper in order to help keep out the wind during the winter months. We did not have a well. We would have to haul water many times or go to a spring to get water. Then later on, when they did dig the well, we had a bucket and a pail. You didn't have no inside bathrooms. You had outside toilets. You didn't have no inside bathtub. You had outside. Had the tin tub, and you bring the water, put on the pot of water for Saturday night because everybody had to take a bath, you know.
My old mother, mighty good mother. My old mother, mighty good mother. My old mother, mighty good mother. She gonna reap just what she sowed. If she sowed good, she gonna reap good. If she sowed good, she gonna reap good. If she sowed good, she gonna reap good. If she gonna reap what she sowed.
In those days, people loved each other. People cared about each other. People shared whatever it was they had. If our cows didn't give milk, we didn't have to worry about milk. We got milk from the neighbors. If my father's, when he would come time to kill hogs, anybody around there, he would send them something, you know, from the hog killing time. Or if somebody didn't have meal or flour, he would share whatever he had. In turn, if we were short something, people shared what they had with us. And if your house needs fixing, they shared that, and it was never a price on it.
Tell them gamblers better quit gambling. Tell them gamblers better quit gambling. Tell them gamblers better quit gambling. Or they gonna reap just what they sow.
My father was 10 years old before he knew he was free. 10 years old before he knew he was free, because he was born in the backwoods of Georgia, and those crackers would not let that information get to colored people. And the only reason my father said he knew they was free, a colored man called a drummer. I don't know what you know what a drummer is supposed to be. He was a fella that went through all the sections, the black sections down there. Everybody had a little farm. And he had sometimes 2 and 3 boxes of cigars strapped with a leather strap on his hand, maybe 2 boxes in that hand. And he had a great big, what they call a Red Cross plaster to his chest. And everybody knew that colored people had the Red Cross plaster, because when they work in the fields, they'd have what they call lumbago, and that Red Cross plaster would all across their chest, and sometimes it was in their back, and sometimes across here, and all like that, you know. You could go to the drugstore and get these plasters, because that was the only thing that would give colored people relief. Papa said this man had a copy of Abraham Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation on his chest, and this thing was plastered over it. He said, because those crackers rode through there with big 45s on the hip on horses all the time, and they'd be like, hey, and he goes, what are you doing? Grab them, come on, baby, come out. Come there. What do you got in them boxes? Well, nothing but cigars. Open them up, let me see.
What's that all in your chest? This is I got a lumbago. This is a Red Cross plaster. When he took his shirt off, all the white people knew the Negroes had Red Cross plasters, so he would let him go. Papa said, when he got to his house, he pulled this thing down and took this so he could read. My papa couldn't read, and his father couldn't read all right, and read it to him. He said, you're free. Abe, old Abe, that's what they call him. Old Abe has signed that proclamation. Says, y'all is free. He said, oh, my goodness. Papa said, to his mother, said, oh, my God, we got to get away from here. What are you going to do? What are we going to do? Papa said, we're going to send you over there to old man so-and-so. That was, his farm was 5 miles over there. 5 miles was nothing for them fellas to go, you know, to go just run that 5 miles in a little while. Mama got up, he said his mother got up that morning, oh, about 4 o'clock, and started cooking things for him so he could take food and things to take for a sandwich and so forth and so on, and give him some, getting ready to give him some clothes. Say, Papa, where are we going to go? Papa, where am I going to go? Old man so-and-so. Then what is he going to do? Don't ask me no question. He'll tell you what to do. Because if you tell Negroes, two little children, so too much, the white people beat it out of them, you know. So you just go over there. He'll tell you what to do. Papa said before his mother could get done making preparations for him to get away, they was going to send the other children someplace else, you know. Wasn't going to send them all together because the white people stopped that right quick. Gonna send one here and one over there to meet the old man so-and-so over there and go on like that's what he was gonna do. See, Papa said they heard the hounds yelping and they knew then the white people had gotten word of what they were gonna do. Papa said when he heard that, they said, son, you got to get. Papa said he left there with a sandwich in his hand and just a little something, a little shirt or something, and he had to bow low because, see, when he jumped out the back door, there was a cornfield and he ducked low, and the white said, "That a little nigger," and started shooting. He probably said he heard the shot, the bird shot, slamming through the cornfield as he's bowing low and running. He didn't stop till he got to old man so-and-so's house, and he told him what happened. Said, "Well, son, you got to get." And he kept on till he got to Savannah. Savannah was a big city, and everybody in Savannah knew the Negroes were free. Papa said he never went back and never saw his mother, his father, nor any of his family from that day till the day he died. He never saw any of them, never went back.
Well, my grandmother was a child of a slave. My great-grandmother had 4 white children and then 4 black children because the old slave masters would ask them to come out to the cotton house or the farm or somewhere out there. And they just went as if that was one of their duties because they was raised pretty good there with this in slavery. They had good slave masters, but some of them didn't have good slave masters. And then all her white children had a different father because my great-grandmother would give them the name of all the fathers of the children. And then it kind of went into you too old or something, then they would just not use her anymore, and that's when she got with the black man, and she was never married, though. She got with the black man, and she had 4 black children, but they were all of the same name. And my grandmother raised all of us. She had 8 children of her own, so we all just had lived there and worked on her farm.
It was a little frame house, no paint on it, just a frame house out there in the country. And it had 3 rooms, kitchen, front room, dining room. But we boys slept up in the attic. It was an attic to the house. See? And we boys, we slept up in the attic. And you can just imagine in the wintertime how cold it would get out there in that old house. And we'd have to get up in the morning, come down and make fires in the fireplace. And a lot of times the water bucket would be froze over and all that. And you got chores such as getting wood. See, back in those days, you had wood fireplaces. And you had to cut wood and get it ready for the winter.
We worked in the field all days through the week. And we went to school. They only had 7th grade for black children. So we had to walk. And when we had to walk 3 miles one way, to our school, which made us walk 6 miles that day. And we would take our lunch in a little metal pail and have our lunch at school. And we got back home. Well, we had chores to do before we went to school. We had to milk the cows and separate the cows from the calves in a pasture and feed the chickens and feed the horses before they got ready to go to plow.
They had white schools, black schools. And then the buses and the trains. We had a section on the bus, which was in the back. And the trains also. But for is getting along with the whites, we didn't have too much of a problem getting along with them. It was just a case of, I guess, if you're in Rome, you act in Rome. That was the way it was all over the South, and that's the way it was where I was.
Mm-hmm. And if it rained when we were at school, well, we just got cold. If it's cold rain, we done the best we could. We didn't have warm clothes, no gloves, or anything like that. We had old union suit once in a while, and the old thing got so awkward looking, and the other girls didn't have to wear them, so we would roll them up from the bottom and had this big roll around each leg. And the white kids would make fun of us because we didn't have no garters, and we would ride the horse downtown in order to sell chickens and milk and eggs and butter, whatever my grandmother had to sell. And of course, my skirt would come up when I would get on the saddle. And they say, oh, I see her stocking garter string, which was just a rag.
When I was going to school there in Alabama, we could not walk up the main street. We went to school on Baptist Hill, which was a black school, high school. And on the way there, there was this white high school, which the bus picked the kids up. We were 6 miles from town, but we had to walk it in the morning and in the afternoon. We were not allowed to walk up the main street in the town. We would have to walk in the back part of town where there was no sidewalks, no cement, and that red Alabama mud would pull your shoes off sometime. But racism was just running rapid there, really bad. If you went in a store and you did not say yes ma'am and no ma'am, regardless of what the age of the clerk was, you didn't get waited on. Same thing if on the telephone. If you wanted to make a long distance call to Chicago, if you didn't say yes ma'am and no ma'am, you did not get through.
Now, if the answer was yes, you know what I'd do? I'd say, oh, I believe so. Looking right in the eye. And if it was no, I don't think so. You see, I never said yes, sir, and no, sir, because they never said that to any of our grown people. The little crackers that high, they would call us the niggas. And I thought about it, I said, well, but did you know, I was glad when I had an opportunity to get away from there, because I know they're beginning to find that out about me. Mm-hmm. One guy said to me, just before I had an opportunity to leave there during the First World War, he said, do you think he's one of them uppity niggas? You see, we had to live so dangerously down there.
Like I said, we never too much come in contact with white folks other than a working relationship. But there was some good. I remember one man there in town, and he had the grocery store. It was called Cobb's Grocery Store. And the other one was Dr. Smith. And there never was any problem between my dad and his white neighbors, because, you see, they had to depend on each other. Like if the rains came, they had to help each other either with gathering of the crops, or the planting season, they had to help each other and depend on each other. So it never was any hostility among the races. Matter of fact, I guess everybody knew where that place was, and they kind of stayed in that place.
And we washed our clothes on a Friday, and we'd iron, starching our little gingham, pongee, and dotted Swiss material. And then we would wash our little hair ribbons and get everything ready for Sunday school and church. The preacher would only come once a month, but he might have four different churches. So he'd come to us every fourth Sunday, and if the weather wasn't permissible, then he didn't come that month. And we paid, my grandmother would pay him with, they'd take a little offering, because we farmers didn't have anything, and maybe pay 25 cents or something each member to give him a little money for his old Model T Ford. And the church was just down by the white school, a mile away from where we had to walk. And my grandmother wouldn't let my uncle hitch up those mules on a Sunday, so we had to walk to church back and forth, no matter what the weather was like, because she said the mules got to rest.
When I was growing up, the church and the school, there was no public education. The school was attached to a church. The church was the survival of people, because out of the church, that's where everybody gathered on a Sunday to fellowship and find out what was going on and around. And the church just played a real role in folks' survival. And my father, who was a deacon, and he would have so many members that he would just have to go ride and see every week, and he collected dues, sometimes 50 cents, a quarter, whatever they could pay. It wasn't so much of the money. It was just the fact that the church's role was to find out how was Aunt Sue? Was she all right? She wasn't at church Sunday. To make sure that somebody stayed in touch with people. And so our Sundays were spent at church. You walked to church and you didn't wear your shoes. You carried a rag and your socks. And when you got near the church, you wiped your feet off and put your shoes and your socks on and you went to church. And later on, when my father got a wagon, we all piled in the wagon and we went to church to stay all day. That was an all day, and that was a real outing, because we would be with other kids, we would be around family, and that was an all day affair when we would go to church on Sunday.
Most of us live maybe a half a mile apart, a mile apart, in some instance 5 miles apart. But we all associated with one another, you know. And some of them was white and some of them was colored. But we all just all good neighbors, that's all.
My grandma, as I said, she raised everything. We raised everything to eat except rice and sugar and flour. That's what we had to buy. And she would go down to the commissary and they would furnish her, what you call furnishing, and they let her buy the sugar, rice, and flour, and any plow instruments like plow points and things of that sort. They let her have that on credit. And they would try to beat her out of her land. And if you made a good crop, then they would take too much of it. They wouldn't give my grandmother a receipt of the things that she bought. He just kept his himself. And he would read off to her what she bought. And she said, well, I didn't buy that. He said, what you doing? Called me a liar? Well, she didn't say no more, because she knew very well if she admitted that she was calling him a liar, then it might be some kind of race riot or something. And so after that, she didn't get any more furnishing from him, which wasn't but the one there. And when after that, we didn't have no more flour to make biscuits or flour bread, whatever. She let us do a whole crop on cornbread and molasses. And we had our own sugar cane. We would strip that cane and strip the leaves off that, strippings off that cane and cut it and bale it up in the wagon. And my uncle would take it and grind to the mill and grind it. And then he would have this big vat and he would cook the syrup until it was done enough to taste. And that's how we had.
On the farm, you have to plant cotton. And usually people try to do their planting by Good Friday. That's the lucky time. Part of that is how you go to school too. Because see, you don't go to school during certain months of the year. You've come out, you work the field, then you go to school, then you come out, and then you work to pick the cotton, then you go back. But anyway, you plant the cotton. And that's the reason they call cotton our king cotton, because cotton in those days was the king. Hey, cotton was the king. Then after you plant the cotton, you had to chop the cotton. See, you had to thin it out to make sure that it grow and pull the weeds out of it, and so it didn't smother the growth of the cotton. Then when July, you always try to be what they call lay by in July. That's you through with the farm then until September. Then when September comes, it's time to August, you start picking cotton. And after, well, the cotton is picked, then there's the corn to be gathered. Then peanuts and potatoes and potatoes and you put in the ground and put hay and stuff over and make a stack so they could keep it outside in the winter time. And see, farm life is, and that's the reason I sympathize with the farmers today, is a hard life. It's an uncertain life, because I remember the year we had the grasshoppers to come through. The quiet months were maybe November, December, and January. Probably October, maybe, if you're lucky and you get all your stuff together.
And then when we picked out our, when we gathered all our crop, then she would let us go out and pick cotton by the hundred. And we picked cotton for a penny a pound, $1 for 100 pounds of cotton. And that was a whole day's work for $1. And they would give us a dollar and dinner.
But we all was very close to one another. And you take, like in the summer, when you harvesting tobacco in the country, you don't do it by yourself. You do it with your neighbors. We'll go to work and they'll harvest my crop. And then we'll move on to the next guys. Now these are the people that lives around you. And we do that until we get all the people around get their crops harvested.
They had sharecroppers. White people would come there sharecropping through the whole South land. And this one couple came there, and my grandmother let us go pick cotton for him when we got through gathering our crop. And we picked out 3 bales of cotton for him. And he just kept telling us, I'm going to pay you when I get the first bale, Jen. I'm going to pay you. And she let us pick that whole 3 bales of cotton out for that man. And when he got everything settled in his cotton gin and sold, he moved. And we don't know where he moved from. Never got paid.
You take like where I work for. Now, I used to work for a very wealthy white man in the South. Matter of fact, he owned practically everything there. And his name was Henry Jones. And the little town was named Jones's Mill, Tennessee. See, it was named after his folks. And I was the only black boy that worked for him. And true enough, all the whites made way more money than I did. But I had more privilege than the average one of them did. I wasn't making too much money, but I was staying right on the place with them, and I was using the cars, the horses, or whatever I wanted to use, which they couldn't do, see? And he used to sit down and talk to me a lot of times. Some days I'd take off from work and go to school. And a lot of mornings he'd come in, I'd be sitting at the table. See, now you see, when you, back in those days, you eat after they eat, see? or either you eat in the kitchen and they eat in the dining room. So anyway, I would be sitting in the dining room eating a lot of mornings, and he'd come in, sit down beside of me, and he'd start to telling me about different things and whatnot that he'd like to get done. And he'd ask me, he'd say, Fon, he'd call me Fon all the time. Fon, are you going to school this morning? I said, yeah, I'm going to school this morning. And then he'd make the remark about what a shame. See, here's a big school right in front of my house, and you can't go to it because you're a black boy. See, I had to walk 5 miles up in the country to go to school, but it was a school right across the road, all white.
Death went out to the sinner's house, come and go with me. Sinner cried out, I'm not ready to go, I ain't got no traveling shoes. Got no traveling shoes, got no traveling shoes. Sinner cried out, I'm not ready to go, I ain't got no traveling shoes. Death went down to preacher's house, called him, come and go with me. The preacher cried out, Lord, I'm ready to go. I got my traveling shoes. Got my traveling shoes. Got my traveling shoes. The preacher cried out, I'm ready to go. I'm got my traveling shoes.